It's just an incredible story of a family, all kinds of success worldwide. These are the people about whom so many myths are created and a lot of misunderstanding. I remember when the Jacksons were here, the Jackson 5 and then the Jacksons. They used to hire five limousines for the Jacksons. And in order to get out of the concert hall, they snuck out a side door into five Pintos to get away. It's hard to believe how people at this early age can deal with this kind of invasion of privacy. What does it do to the emotional well-being of the person himself? And is it lonely at the top? And after all they've been through, I must tell you that it's hard to find three people who are as much in admiration of each other and understanding. And it wasn't always that way. I am pleased to present one of the most successful recording groups in the history of sound. Please welcome the Bee Gees, right here.
Stay up my heart, living high.
Well, if it's been a while since you've been to Dick Clark's bandstand, let me just review for a moment. Morris and Robin are twins. Yes, they're not identical twins. And in fact, I think you're on record as saying you don't even feel like a twin. There's a lot about you that's different, but much that's the same.
Absolutely.
Barry, of course, the senior brother of the group, the old man who watches over his younger brother. And these are the Bee Gees. Barry's born in 1946.
That's good.
40. 40 what?
49.
49. Yeah. All right. That's the end of our show. You were born on the Isle of Man, is that?
That is correct.
And that's between England and Ireland?
Between England and Ireland is a little island in the Irish Sea.
Yes.
And we left the Isle of Man when I was about 5 and Morris and Robin were about 3.
And your father was a musician?
He was a drummer, and he actually used to work on the ferry between the mainland, Liverpool, and the Isle of Man.
Uh-huh. Now you go to Brisbane. You take the big trip to...
That's a big step. Yeah. No, what happened was when we were 5, we left the Isle of Man and came to live in England, in Manchester. Yeah. And about 1958, we emigrated to Australia, and we lived in Brisbane.
You were never crazy about Australia. Nice people.
Not true. Not true.
But
we all have mixed feelings about it.
I'm sorry?
We all have mixed feelings about that. But,
The show business that we're in, the show business in Australia was very, very young in those days.
Yeah.
And
let's
it was just, difficult.
Yeah, let's say that the show business in Australia wasn't altogether kind to us. We were very young.
Yes.
But the country's beautiful. I mean,
what's so important, I think, about this story, which is, it's just, if you want to put it in terms of money, I don't know what we're talking about, millions and millions and millions of dollars that you folks, your talent, your creative energies, your writing, your execution, your records, your nightclubs, concerts.
Yes.
underneath all that success,
yes,
has been from childhood a driving, tremendous ambition, yeah, on the part of all of you.
Yeah.
Now, how do we all get that so that we can make it to the next paycheck? You must have thought about this a lot.
We also thought about giving up many times.
Oh, yeah.
But, these were periods that were extremely bad for us, you know, between 1970 and 1974. We couldn't sell records to get a hot dinner, you know.
No, we had down periods.
Oh, I know.
Yeah.
But you hit it as very young people in Australia. You played the ovals. You played racetracks. Isn't
no, we actually, the only places you could work when we eventually moved down to Sydney, you had to make it big in Australia. You had to go to Sydney. That's where all the TV networks are.
The New York,
the big city. Yeah.
So we go down there, and the only places you could work are RSL clubs, which are working men's clubs. Basically, they're similar to Vegas type clubs, are the one-armed bandits and a lot of money flowing into big stages and things. But we never worked to teenagers. We worked to adults for years before we worked to teenagers.
Now that's a very important feature of your own professional development. You were in there as children singing what mums and dads wanted to hear.
That's right.
I don't know whether that's... So what? But isn't that important, though, in terms of your own development?
Well, not really. At that particular time, we were doing it because we needed to make money for the family.
Oh, sure, but I agree. I think it was very important.
Yeah, well, it was important, yeah.
With rap arts between an audience and yourself, I mean, that was where it was important.
Is there any way, this is a little exploitive, but can you just suggest for us, believe me, we don't expect, this is not Lincoln Center, but what would be an example of the kind of material that you would have done? This would
guitar.
Be now what? The late
he picks up guitar nonchalantly.
Now, you were how old at this time, Barry? You weren't even 16.
Well, this goes before even that, where I would have been 14, Morris and Robin would have been about 11. When we used to do nightclubs. And, Blackbird or,
this stuff you heard is right, you know.
All right.
Apologizing before we sing it. So,
well, yeah,
this is 1959
why.
Now, right? 1959.
Yeah, I thought it was 1981.
All right.
Going back.
All right.
The time warp.
How are you doing?
I apologize for not knowing
the words. Oh,
you can sing it.
Here I go. I'm singing. I apologize.
You know the harmony?
That's an example. You can sing it.
Now, stay there for a second because this pleased the adults in the audience.
Well,
a few of them. But you also, then, the three of you, you must have been cute as
anything. Hell. There was a certain attraction to us being young, obviously. It's right. Like seeing the cuteness when we were singing adult songs. You know, and they used to say, you know, we could really get away with murder sometimes because we used to just pull faces. But we do sing a lot of the older songs.
Do what?
Puff.
Wow. Oh, that's even, that's way back.
Yeah, I don't know the word either.
Oh, God. Let's do, I Know When You'll Pick Up.
Lollipop, lollipop,
But you could not get the respect of young people.
Not for singing that.
Not with that material.
not by singing Puff either.
Yeah, but not only that, you were young yourselves.
Yeah.
The point is, apparently, when you're 14, at least at that time, your hero was not likely to be somebody else who's 14.
No, that's right.
So what was the, wasn't there a night when you said...
Well, this was before the Beatles, so I would guess... Oh, what would our influences have been around that time?
Well, there was Everly Brothers, the Everly Brothers, Neil Sedaka songs, like Happy Birthday, Sweet 16, all that stuff.
Mm-hmm. Paul Anka?
Basically, because they had the three harmonies. And the Everly Brothers stuff, we used to just add the third harmony.
All right, now, very quickly, we're going to...
Yes.
You did, apparently, though, not with the permission of your father, and rather on your own. You were certainly not wooden soldiers, even at that age. You were... Didn't you guys have a fight... one time at a nightclub, I mean, we're rolling around the floor, and the comedians on the bill are watching you, and you're cute.
Well, now, let me explain. Most people...
Oh, let's explain.
Oh, yeah, let's explain. My own voice here. Now, I always hear my own voice. Anyway, these places that we worked in Australia were called RSLs, and RSLs actually are initials for Return Soldiers Leagues clubs or something
Return
like that.
Return Servicemen.
And we were doing them because, basically, our family... needed the money. So we that's why we did it, working to adults. We weren't really doing it because it was our music.
We'll get to the fight.
So anyway, the fight. Shut up. Now, the fight was generally because, you know what adults are like when they go to nightclubs. Yeah. This is from a child.
You know, Phil.
They get drunk and they fight and there's this pervading smell of stale beer. And you'll get the odd sort of in there, you know, sort of servicemen and people like that coming into these kind of clubs because it was a Return Soldiers club, and therefore they start fighting everywhere. So actually,
we
didn't fight, we just watched.
Yeah,
there would be people sitting at tables that would actually have. Australians are a great race of people, they're very aggressive, and if a fight breaks out, it just breaks out at the drop of a hat. Anybody will fight in Australia. So you can do a show, and two men will be sitting at a table fighting, they won't be standing up. They'll actually be sitting there hitting each other across the table.
And you're singing Lollipop.
Oh, no, we're singing
Lollipop. Well, My Old Man's a Dustman. We used to sing all that.
Yeah. You know. But apparently a moment came when, I suppose this was still before the Beatles' influence.
Yeah.
But Chuck Berry?
We never really got into Chuck Berry, funny enough.
Yeah. So we were always on the outer fringes.
How about Bill Haley? Wasn't
yeah. Yeah. Well, but that
one,
was much,
two,
much
three
earlier.
Now, yeah.
Well, that's
you knew you wanted that. Is that right?
We knew when I was 7 years old, I knew what I wanted to do. Robin and Morris were still coming up. When they reached about 6 or 7 years old, there was no doubt in our minds where we wanted to go. There was no doubt that we were going to be in show business, that education was important, but we knew what we were going to do when we grew up.
But you were performing as good little boys, pleasing, and you were also doing shtick on the stage, which was very cute and very adult appreciative.
Yes, we had to work with much older people.
So in many ways then, you were young, you were little boys on the stage behaving as the adults wanted little boys to behave.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right.
You were doing little funny things.
Well, you know, kids and dogs, you can't go wrong. You know?
Right. And you knew that. But what was also happening here is you young men were thrust into the middle of an adult world. I assume you never really had any... Your maturation was short-circuited, I guess is what I'm saying.
We were working from 1955 on stage onward.
Surrounded by adults, you saw the money exchange, you saw the arguments, you saw the disagreements, and here were these little... boys standing there watching all this.
A lot of people have asked us, like, aren't you afraid that you missed a real, you know, sort of normal childhood? Because all our life we've been mixing with adults and so on, growing up very quickly. We left school when we were 13, and basically because there was anything at school that could teach us regarding the business we were in and that we loved. So we grew up very quickly.
No, we always feel that everybody else missed our childhood.
It was a great childhood.
We had an amazing childhood.
We had a great time.
You did. You liked it.
Yeah, absolutely.
But you were brothers. I mean, I assume there was jealousy and some sibling rivalry at that
time. Yeah, as always. it'll always be the case with any three sessions, right.
Listen, this isn't an investigation, but it's it would be misleading to say that you three folks, in a loving, cooperative way, stepped forward in every instance and got on with each other. It's
not oh, no, we've had our fights.
All right. What was the moment, then, that you got out of pleasing mums and dads?
Day before yesterday, wasn't it?
when did you leave?
When we went to England.
When the Merseybeat boom, and we all remember that, came into being about 1965 to 67. Where are you going?
Walk backwards, you don't mind.
We decided we had to leave Australia and come back to England to try and join what was happening. We felt we could compete with other groups in England. It was all happening in England. It's just simple to say that.
But didn't you experiment with the rock sound before you left Australia?
Well, we had 13 flops in a row.
Well, hang on a second.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of experiments. This period, which was...
He's gone again.
I'm off.
You're all right. Okay. You're all right. It is a bit hot, isn't it? No, anyway... in this period, about 1964, 65, is when the Beatles were coming up, and we were getting growing up at that time and starting to, finding our feet in our own music and realizing that, you know, the kind of things we've been doing weren't for us. And
but we have been recording and things like that for many years.
But not in our own sort of criteria, in our own sort of spectrum, as it were.
To make it, in those days, to make it internationally, you had to leave Australia.
I
mean, it was just nowhere else to go, so we had to. Just
all right. So your 16-year-old brother, and you then would have been 13 at the time?
About that, yeah.
13 years old. And guess what? Your 16-year-old brother, if I am reading the right reviews here, took himself a wife before leaving Australia.
That's right. Oh, no.
Filthy dog.
You didn't tell us.
It's amazing.
Which? You're talking about Andrew?
No,
talking about you, lad.
Talking about me? Oh, my God.
Andrew.
No, I thought you were referring to Andy because that also happened to Andy, but I'm answering the question. I was 19 when I was first married, and so was Andy, so the 16 doesn't even come into it.
Oh, I see. I thought you were 16 when you left Australia.
No, I was 19.
You were 19. Okay, I got it.
We were about 16.
Actually, he was 14 when he took a wife.
but it was also true, just for the sake of understanding what this kind of attention can do. There are lots of folks out there with people who want to be like you. And I guess you'll pardon me for trying to get into your soul here and wonder how this might have affected you emotionally. First of all, you said, didn't you, you were engaged to six women at the same time, I think, when you were a teenager.
It's all coming back now, isn't it?
Heaven. You must have been a very popular fellow.
He was very busy. Yes.
Well, I had a bicycle.
Yes.
Things were a little easier. It's not as easy without a bicycle. But
you were very popular.
When I was around that age, yes, I was. I was terrible.
And these girls would be waiting for you at the stage door every night. All right. So you're 19. All right. You go. So you're 19 and you're 16 then at the time you leave Australia. You go to London and trying not to belabor this. You were. Obviously, intent on being a big hit in London. Your folks accompanied you to England. Then you heard from you called him Mr. Stickweed.
Stickweed,
Mr. Stickweed. It turned out to be Robert Stigwood, who was.
Well, to this day, we don't really know how he got our phone number. We arrived in England, in Southampton. We were told by another group on the dock, dressed up like the Beatles were. They said, "Go back. Groups are out." This is 1967. Groups are out. Yeah. You know, this was the general word.
Most disheartening.
So. We thought that we didn't have a chance, and we went to different agencies, and they said, "Sorry, boys, we can get you some club work, but groups are out." This was everywhere in London. People were saying this. Yeah. Well, groups are still in, you know, but this is what they were saying. So,
mind you, the group that said it on the docks were out.
Yeah.
Just because they weren't in. Yeah.
The warning was from everyone. All the signs were, "Don't do it. Go back. Go back to Australia." You know. So we were there about 2 weeks after seeing all the agents and. Our father suddenly got a call from a man who we thought was Mr. Stickweed, who wanted to speak to him. He was Brian Epstein's partner. And he said, "We'd like to interview the boys and have them audition for us, or this man." You know. Well, we still don't know to this day how he got that phone number, and he won't tell us. But, So we went down to a place called the Savile Theatre, which has been pulled down now. It's gone. And we did an audition for Robert Stigwood. And he was a little worse for wear. He'd
had a heavy night.
A heavy night before, and sort of staggered in with the aid of two people. sat down and stared at the floor and said, carry on.
No, this was 1967 to be fair to Robert.
You must be fair to Robert.
Now he has three people.
No, but he was very nice. He wasn't really up to listening to us, but we said, you know, he said, go ahead. And we sang, we did our Peter, Paul and Mary segment, which is what we used to do on stage. Pop the Magic Dragon and so forth. And he said, will you come back to my office this afternoon and we talk again? So we went back to his office that afternoon, and we had agreed at that point to sign a five-year deal with NEMS, which is the Brian Epstein stable organization. And then we cut our first record, and that was...
And titles, can you share with us what titles then sort of allowed you to reach for the big ring then after...
What titles, you mean what songs?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Well, this is the first hit. For those who may not remember it.
New York.
Yeah.
Of something happening to me, there is something I would like you all to see. It's just a photograph of someone that I knew. Have you seen my wife, Mr. Jones? Do you know what it's like on the outside? Don't go talking too loud, you'll cause a landslide. Mr. Jones, I keep straining my ears to hear a sound. Maybe someone is digging underground. Or have they given up and all gone home to bed? Thinking those who once existed must be dead. Have you seen my wife, Mr. Jones?
Chicago with the Bee Gees, and we'll be back in just a moment. When did you throw out the Brill Cream?
I threw out the Brill Cream when I got fed up with slipping off the pillow at night.
No, our father used to always, it was always, Robin actually is the person you're asking, he's the right one, because our father's rap art would always be, tell Robin to comb his hair. Or tell Robin to clean his shoes. And he wouldn't tell Robin, he'd come to me or Morris and he'd say,
see, our father was that generation of fathers that when people started growing long hair, you know, you look like a girl,
yeah,
or, you know,
that
kind of, you know, in the Beatles and stuff.
You were identified as the metaphysical deepest thinker.
Oh, the nutcase.
Yes.
But there's a thin line between
there is
brilliant.
There is.
You know, the influence of the Beatles is very apparent in that. The New York Minder.
Yes, right.
Very.
Absolutely.
However, I must point out,
not surprisingly.
No.
I must point out that a lot of groups that came from the north of England did have this kind of musical sort of
rapport. Well, I think you have to say that everybody in the world was influenced by the Beatles.
Oh, yeah.
Who the artist
was.
We come from an England, actually, where we lived most of our younger life, is Manchester, and which is 30 miles from Liverpool.
Yes.
So you can talk like this, and you can be an octave lower. But then you can sing with a nasalness. So there was a lot of groups in the north of England.
I think you find the Hollies had a sound similar to the Beatles too. It's all that accent and the nasalness.
Well,
of
not
the
only that, there's an urgency to this. You know, it's
everyone's trying to get a hit.
The Beatles had that.
Yeah.
Now we're coming up toward. Now you're all over the place, all over the world, and all kinds of things are happening to you. And was it at this time that you started to express your own self? Was R&B the influence for you?
Yeah.
It was.
Yeah.
And this is when you really began to act like adults in charge of your own lives, is that?
Well, we've always, yeah, I guess so, but we've always been very much into black music. We love black music. It's the finest that there is in pop music. I mean, black people have the ability to out-sing white people. It's just as simple as that. Yeah. And we're just very much into it. We love it. So we will try and emulate it. We will try and do it ourselves. And a lot of, there are what you call, is it Blue-Eyed Soul, I think is the tag. And we ventured into that area because it had always been an influence, right back as far as To Love Somebody, whoever may remember that song. Yeah. It was very much soul-orientated. We've always been into that, from Otis Redding right up to now.
All right. You know. Now it's 1969, and you are, all of you, in for some of the brief, the bleakest right. years of your lives. Yeah. I think you decided to go alone and...
It was no one decision by any of us. It was just he's gone. Every time we start talking about something, no, he's away. Anyway, it's all right.
I don't mind.
It is hot in here. Okay. And it's your show. Okay, and anyway, it was the kind of a period where we were getting ego, maniacal.
We were getting people who would join up with each one of us individually and try to talk that one of us into going solo.
You don't need the other two.
Right.
You've got to remember, this is the first time we were sort of experiencing fame on this kind of level. And the only time we knew what each other was doing was when we picked up the weekly trade.
Tore us apart.
Mm. You know, and I thought, oh, see, Barry.
We were reading about each other in the papers.
Yes, that's right. Oh,
yeah. And you were reading some nasty things that you were,
right.
others were...
We didn't understand that the press made up things.
So one brother would say, one brother would say one thing one next week, and the next week another brother would answer that remark, but the other brother
said the week guy would knock on the door and say, I've got a comment here from your brother Barry, he said he's going to do this and this. How do you feel about that, you know?
Yeah. And he also says the girl you're with isn't good for you. And
lots of different things.
Well, she ran off with your brother.
Yeah. Little things like that, you know.
So somebody goes over to somebody's house, and you're surrounded by lawyers, and you have lawyers speaking for you, and it gets to be
right. Totally out of hand.
Great drama.
Actually, while all the lawyers and everyone was discussing things, we were sitting on the couch discussing getting back together. They didn't know this.
You know, when we were discussing getting back together again, it's the lawyers that came in and said, hey, you can't do this, there's too much money involved.
Right.
Yeah. You know, not for them, for us, but for them, you see.
But for the record, there was a considerable undercurrent between all of you.
That's right.
Only brothers know what that can be like.
That's
really emotionally were
divided. You can only put it in the terms that we were not friends anymore. Yeah. We were still brothers, but we couldn't get along with each other.
Yeah. We were growing up.
So,
I was still very young at this point. I mean, me and Morris were 17.
Sudden fame is such a destructive thing.
Right. Yeah. All right. So here's the money, here's the lawyers, here's the greed, here's the ego, here's the childhood that's maybe never happened, and we've got all kinds of bloody things going on, and you're reading about each other in the paper. Okay. Now, it was also at this time, I assume that you don't mind speaking to this, that drugs entered the scene.
Yeah.
Somebody got on speed.
Well, no, we're all on.
Those are the days where everyone...
Actually, what it was is that one time Barry was smoking pot and Ron would be on pills and I'd be drinking, so it'd be pilly potty and...
and that's what we kept doing.
That pretty well takes care of...
But what you're talking about...
we can only assume the show will play in Mississippi. We'll wait and see.
I don't think people object.
No.
Well, no one is supposed to talk about sex.
We shouldn't be frightened by language. There's
but we should go on. We should go on to mention that the area you're talking about, the period you're talking about, is between 68 and 1970, and it was the flower power period.
Yeah.
It was craziness all over this country and all over England. There wasn't anybody that you knew that wasn't on some form of drug.
Yeah.
That also applies today. But it doesn't apply to us anymore.
We're not talking about people that just in the business as well. People that weren't in the business.
Everybody.
Yeah. was absolutely standard. It was not.
Do you have any? Can you share with us anything about how does? is it something you felt you were entitled to do, or is it just because it was all around and after the big
all
night?
Around, get on the wagon.
Part of being the part of everybody. I mean, there was parties we go to, and you see your Beatles there and
in
whoever
fact,
else.
We never indulged. We never indulged in LSD. We never indulged in any form of mind-changing drug. Whatever we ever took at that age would have been something called Excedrin, which is like a pet pill. Yeah.
But pot isn't mind-altering drug.
Well,
for the record, all right.
Yeah. Okay, but we can't get into that subject. But it's long-term.
It makes you stone, so I guess it is.
Yes, I guess it does.
Makes you pretty high.
So what was this? A couple of years, then 2-3 year period where you both, I assume you took something up to get up and then down to get down. Did you have to moderate it?
That's pretty good.
You know, in my case, it was drinking. I just drank.
I hear music.
Well, just finish your point and then we'll get out.
Yeah, it's just that you know you go for hours and hours and hours, like working in the studio, and if you're up, you know you just exhaust yourself.
So you go to sleep anyway.
I see.
So you fall down.
And we'll be back with the Fijis in just a moment.
Oh,
The Bee Gees, when we last left you, you were...
we were on drugs.
Variously, yes. So that lasted for what, a couple, 3 years? I guess, how did you get off? And how do you... We hear so much about the folks who don't come back. You guys did.
Well, you know, there's a difference between a person who takes these things for their work and staying awake in the studio and the person who's an addict. For instance, a person who's an addict takes them because he needs them or she needs them to stay
you
normal.
You never got there.
No, no, we were never drug addicts. We just used drugs for our work to create.
Yeah.
To keep ourselves awake in the studio for long periods of time. It wasn't anything that was actually an addict or a habit one had to keep.
And every band was doing just that.
All right. Yeah. Now, well, also musically, when we last left you, you were the Beatles' influence was apparent.
Right.
In the New York Mine Disaster.
Right.
Now, could you give us an example of the next step, sort of the next step in your development?
The next actual step in our development, this is where we actually broke up. This was where we broke up and then we got back together again. And what happened then?
Well, I think you're talking about the falsettos and...
No, this was much earlier than that.
What do you mean, Lonely Days?
I think Phil's talking about an example of the new kind of music that we got into.
No, you're jumping right ahead from that period.
Well, what the next step was following that period.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
Chaos.
That period.
We broke up. This whole thing lasted about 2 years. And then we came back together again because the company we were signed to was going public and they needed us to look like a whole entity.
All right. So can you give us an example, just a brief example, of your musical signature at that time?
At that time?
There you're making a mess of the staging. Staging.
I can still feel the breeze. I could never see tomorrow. No one said a word about the sorrow. A broken heart. How can you stop the rain from falling down?
Yes.
off the top of the head?
Well, you. Perhaps we should bring the lights down. You had discussed with us something that you would.
It's very difficult unless we go into falsetto, which is also strange.
Could be very painful.
All right.
Well, that's good. That's a song that somebody would.
Not too much happen.
Well, even that, you know.
We should be dancing. Be hysterical.
Why don't you ask us something else? And while you're asking us, we'll still be thinking of what that might be.
What was the year then? You had bad times from 70 to 74, even though the reunion had taken place. You really weren't burning any town.
No, we felt we were placed back together before we were actually ready as people to come back together.
Right. That's right.
We went through a very low period.
All right. I know we're skipping a lot of stuff, but we've got to get to
now you're going into the area where we did... Good morning, Mr.
Lonely Days.
the year do you spend doing concerts?
How much time do we spend during doing concerts? Well, the last tour we did was about just over a year ago, a year and a half ago. And we don't have another American tour planned until about 83. So the next tour...
Only because we're so busy in the recording studio all the time, that's the thing.
Well, no, the next tour we are doing will be a world tour, and that'll be about the end of the summer of 83, in which we'll probably include this country as well.
Yeah.
Considering the pressures that you know of in show business, would you want your kids to get into this business?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Would you help them?
Well, no. In our point of view, though, our children, whatever they want to do with themselves is perfectly all right with
us. But as parents, do you want a 13-year-old son of yours out there entertaining the USO or the Australian?
Sure. We were 13-year-old sons, and we loved every second of it. Mm-hmm. So it's, you know.
Yeah.
Do you find that being in the business and having this popularity and the women after you, does this interfere with your personal life?
Oh, no. No. Of course it does.
Well,
I think it's wonderful.
Yeah. Out of all your experiences in different situations, what have you, like, personally benefited from the most?
From each other.
Yeah.
It's got to be the real truth, you know. That bearing up of the three of us and the strength that comes from the three of us to each other, I think, is...
Can we meet your wife?
Sure.
Sure.
Yes. Linda, my wife, right there in the middle. Yeah. And
Rep, stand up, Linda.
Yeah,
Linda,
stand up, Linda.
Thank you.
Cool. And that's my wife, Yvonne.
You plan to stand up? Yeah.
We're in Chicago with the Bee Gees, and we'll be back in just a moment.
In the moment that you wander far from me, I want to feel you in my arms again.
This is directed for Barry. I loved your Guilty tape.
Oh,
and
thank
is
you.
Barbara Streisand, how is she to work with? Is she an easy person, nice person?
It's easy for me to answer. She's a really nice lady. All of the things I heard about her, I never saw evidence of the whole time I worked with her. And this is not show business chat. She's an exceptionally nice lady. She knows what she wants, but she likes to be criticized. So it's all kinds, it's a give and take with Barbara. She'll be very strong 1 minute, and she'll be asking your opinion the next minute. It's a nice relationship. She's a nice lady.
Do you ever get tired of singing the same song?
That's a good question. Some songs. Yeah. Not all songs, but on tour, yes, because you have to do the same songs every night, and it's demanded of you. So sometimes what you do is you try to get a new vitality every time you sing it.
Do the three of you sit down and discuss what you're going to write about, or does one just basically write the song?
No, the three of us sit down and discuss. That's the first answer, the first comment is absolutely right.
A lot of things that are happening today revolve around music, teenagers listening to music. Do you feel any responsibility to America's youth with the words that you use in your songs?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Could you, for example of that?
Well, yes. It's very important. Yes, I'd like to give an example, and that example is the new single, which is called Living Eyes. And the lyrics to that single are, Living Eyes, When Under the Sun Don't Cry.
Record is not out yet, by the way.
Yes, it basically refers to everybody, and that we should all be a hell of a lot nicer to each other. That's basically what the song says.
Yeah.
Which is the UNICEF album.
Yeah.
How many children do each of you have?
I have three children, Stephen, Ashley, and Travis, who's a baby.
Robert?
Yeah.
You have another question, is it?
No.
How many children have you got? I have two children. I have no wife yet.
Yes. Yeah, I have two children, a boy and a girl.
Yes. What means of travel do you use when you're on tour?
Lipton.
What means of travel?
Oh, what means? What name we use? They said what name.
Is that what you said? What means of travel?
Yes.
Yeah, Lipton tea.
Out of all the songs that you've ever written, which one do you feel that you put yourself into most?
Well, that's an individual answer from each brother, you see. So
yes.
I guess for Robin, it's hard to say. For me, it's words.
Yeah.
How did the names Bee Gees originate?
Well, it's for brothers Gibb.
Well, we were discovered singing in a speedway, a racing car speedway in between the races. And the guy that discovered us, well, you call it discovered, our mother and father really discovered us.
Bill Gates.
Those, you know.
Yeah.
His name was Bill Gates, and he had the same initials as my initials and our mother's initials. So we called it by those initials BG, and we made him into words later on.
Yeah. Is your brother Andrew younger than you are? And
I hope so.
Yes, he is.
Yes,
yes.
Yes. Andy's about 23.
Mm-hmm.
And
yes.
And
incidentally, recently enjoyed the highlight of his career as a public performer, appearing on The Donahue Show.
Listen, that's why we wanted to do it.
I noticed a special closeness as a family and also as working together. Mm-hmm. I noticed the cross on your neck. Does Christianity have anything to do with it?
Oh, sure. Mm. But we're not the kind of people that will say, you know, everybody's got to do it.
No.
It's just what we feel inside is another thing. What we wear on our necks may signify that, but we don't
say,
you know.
I've got a microphone on my
neck. Do you guys have a favorite album that you made or song?
We just finished it.
That's our favorite album.
Yeah.
Favorites? Anybody with a request? How's this for free?
Staying Alive. I like that one.
Well, just a little of it, because singing in falsetto is very difficult to do.
This should be fun.
He's very good.
Very good.
Short.
Right.
We don't have a band to give you the beat, so.
You can tell by the way I use my voice.
Do you three always plan to sing together? What do you think you're going to involve
after that,
into?
I don't know.
What do you think we're going to evolve into?
Yeah.
God, I don't know.
The ambition's still there, huh?
Oh, yes. As ever, it's like a driving force, and we have to keep finding out where else we can go. You know?
I just wondered how the guys like Victoria Principal.
We don't talk about sex on this show.
No sex.
Thank you.
No, no.
Doing anything with Streisand again?
Anything with Barbara again?
Because she does one-off things, you know. She doesn't like to repeat things, and the same thing applied with Donna Summer and those things, you know. She'll go on to something else.
Is it true your Saturday Night Live, you produced it right away?
Saturday Night Fever. Just give us that for a moment. You were writing the music in another country, were you not? With only a general idea of what this is about, a guy who's going to win money dancing.
Well, they gave us the idea, but we'd already written the songs. They said, you know, we need about 3 or 4 songs for a film called... first of all, we gave them the title. They didn't have a title, and we suggested Night Fever, and they said, well, that's a bit pornographic, isn't it, you know? So we said, well, yeah, it depends how you apply it. In the end, they used the title Night Fever, so... But we'd already written Night Fever and Staying Alive and How Deep Is Your Love before they really got down to asking us to do the music. So we merely applied those songs. We played them to them, and they said, that's great. They went away happy, and that's how it turned out.
We've very little time left.
Yeah.
They said what?
Yeah.
I had heard that you did it like an hour's worth of time.
No, we were in Herrebel outside Paris for about 6 weeks. And the first week we had those songs written, and the second week they asked us to write the music for the film. So it was all done within about 7 days.
And we'll be back in just a moment. For one heck of a show, and I certainly, for one, am very grateful. The title song from the new album is Livin' Eyes. We don't have time for it all, but take us out with Livin' Eyes,
sure.
The Bee Gees, right here.
Yesterday, but be alive. I know that we will.
services provided and promotional fees paid by the following.
The new Volvo GLT Turbo. Our engineers love it for sound engineering reasons. Our test drivers just love it.
Another lap.
Super scrubbable TrueTest Easy Care Latex flat wall and trim finish. Perfect for both walls and woodwork. Sold only by True Value Hardware Stores and Home Centers.